do that. I'll do it right now. Okay. Hey, good morning. I want you to join in prayer with me right now. I guess it was Friday night. Our school was having a family night here to celebrate the end of basketball. And Gio Diaz fell and hit his face against the bleachers. And I think he's either in surgery right now or he's finished with that. So, Father, we lift Gio up to you right now. Lord, we're asking you to reach out your hand to him, to touch him and bring healing, Lord. Restore his jaw, Lord God. Lord, I pray that you would minimize the pain, that you would guide the hands of the doctors and those that minister to him, and that, Father, you would just bring him back to complete wholeness, Father. Lord, we also lift up Israel. He has back trouble. And so, Father, we ask you to touch his body. Lord, while we're at it, anybody else in here that needs a touch from the power of your Holy Spirit, I ask you to come and bring healing, bring comfort. Lord, comfort those that grieve. Comfort the hurting this morning, Father God. Lord, I pray that you would give us hope through your word today. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Ladies, the men will be serving you, so please sign up for that ladies' conference. This is what I noticed. Did you notice when Carrie came up here and talked about the throne of grace, everybody just stayed standing? You've never stood for my announcements. But did you notice how the Spirit of God was at work already? And one thing I can sense when the Spirit of God is in a place working, and he was working here. So we pray that he continues. Amen? All right. Faith to face the cross. It's the same title as last week, because I believe that's where we're supposed to be as we lead up to the Resurrection Sunday. And if you can remember from last week, we talked about the time, it was actually in Mark chapter 8, where Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do the people say I am?" And then Peter spoke up and said, "You're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God." And then right after Peter made that confession of faith and he admitted that he believed that Jesus is the Son of God, then Jesus said to him he was going to go to Jerusalem, be delivered into the hands of the chief priests and the elders, and that he would die and rise again in 3 days. So Peter, once he exhibited faith in Christ, then Jesus told him what was going to happen and how salvation was going to come about. Today we're going to be in Mark chapter 9. We're going to read about the transfiguration, and we're going to take the next step that Jesus took with his disciples on the way to the cross. So with that, I'm going to begin reading, and the point I want you to see is Jesus is going to reveal his glory to his disciples, and he takes his three favorites, Peter, James, and John, and he's going to reveal his glory to them. I'm beginning in Mark chapter 9. He said to them, "I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power." After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him, and he led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it's good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my Son whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing what rising from the dead meant. And they asked him, "Why do the teachers of the law say that Elijah must come first?" Jesus replied, "Be sure, Elijah does come first and restores all things. Why then is it written that the Son of Man must suffer much and be rejected? But I tell you, Elijah has come, and they have done to him everything they wished, just as it is written about him." I'm going to jump over now to verse 30, same chapter, same time frame. They left that place and they passed through Galilee, and Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that your Holy Spirit would come and that you would bring revelation. Lord, that we would learn things we didn't know today because your Spirit would bring that revelation in Jesus' name. Amen. The first verse of the text where Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power." If you're reading in your outline, verse 1 refers to the day of Pentecost and the start of the church. I want you guys to know that Jesus always gives hope. How's your hope today? Seem kind of sluggish in here today and like people are tired. Do you have hope or are you kind of hopeless? I was watching the news last night. That was my first mistake. But you know what I realized? I realized that lawlessness is beginning to abound more and more. The scripture says, because lawlessness abounds, the love of many will wax cold. And Jesus, in the text, he begins here, and he's given the disciples hope. He says, the kingdom of God, it's coming. It's coming. And he's speaking about the day of Pentecost. And he's speaking about the beginning of the church. Because these men were all going to be alive when that happened on the day of Pentecost. And so he points them out, and he's given us hope. If you're in here today, I pray that you have hope. Because if you don't, life is boring, and it's just depressing. And if you have Christ in your heart, you should have hope. You should have hope. If you're following your outline, Jesus reveals his glory to his small group. Have you noticed that Jesus has favorites? He does. Peter, James, and John. He leaves all the other disciples down at the bottom, and then he takes Peter, James, and John up on the mountain with him, and they were all alone up there. I believe God has designed us this way. You have certain people that mentor you, or that you mentor, or that you get close to, and they're your inner circle, and they're the people that influence you the most, and you influence them. So Jesus takes these three up, and he reveals his glory to them. They were so used to seeing Jesus wearing the same clothes every day. See, I think Jesus only had one or two outfits at the most. Says he didn't have any place to rest his head. He didn't own a home. Reminds me of my dad. My dad always wore bib overalls. When my dad went to the bank, he would put on a clean pair of bib overalls. If my dad got dressed up, there was a wedding or a funeral, one or the other. But that was what my dad did. That was who he was. If you saw him and he didn't have his bibs on, there was something wrong. Something was different. So the disciples go up the mountain. They see Jesus. He looks like he's always looked before. And all of a sudden, Jesus is glorified. He's just lit up. If you're following in your outline, his appearance was out of this world. It says he was whiter than anybody could bleach his clothes. In other words, it was supernatural. It wasn't something that could be made up by a man. And so Jesus, they saw him in his glory up on the mountain. I think this would be better than watching Clark Kent go into the phone booth and come out as Superman. If you could get there on that mountain today and see Jesus in his glory. And he's just lit up. Remember the title, Faith to Face the Cross. What do you think that did for the disciples? To see Jesus glorified before them. Wow. As if that weren't enough, Jesus is joined by Moses and Elijah. I think the disciples were still in shock, and then they looked up, and here's these two guys. One was taken by the chariot, right? And he took off, and then nobody knows what happened to Moses. He went up on the mountain by himself. And here they appear with Jesus, speaking to Jesus. If you're following in your outline, how did they recognize Jesus' visitors? Isn't that a great question? How did they know this was Moses and Elijah? Was one guy carrying the Ten Commandments? I mean, how did they come up about with this? How did they know who he was, who they were? Maybe they heard Jesus go, Moses, Elijah, good to see you. Did anybody maybe paint a portrait of them when they were alive so that they knew what he looked like? I don't know. They couldn't look it up on the internet. But somehow they knew it was Moses and it was Elijah. It could be that the power of God's Spirit was so awesome there that they just knew. But somehow they knew because it's recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke that he met with Moses and with Elijah. Now, Luke chapter 9 and verse 31 tells us what the three glorified men spoke about, all right? Chapter 9 and verse 31. In verse 30, it says, the two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor, talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. So it tells us what they spoke about. They spoke about Jesus' departure. The actual word is they spoke about his exodus. How he was going to leave this world. How he was going to die. Interesting subject, isn't it? Have you ever taken time to talk about what's going to happen when you leave this world? Or think about it even? Some people go, oh, I'd rather not talk about that. I think I want to be ready. I want to be ready. But here they came and they spoke to Jesus about going to the cross and what he was going to do. Now I pray that once again the Holy Spirit would take you into the text. Don't just read over it and go, oh, that was cool. Yeah, great to meet with Moses and Elijah. But what was the reasoning? They came and they talked to Jesus. Could it be that Jesus needed to be encouraged? He was fully man, wasn't he? Can you imagine what was going through him? In just a short period of time, he's going to be at Gethsemane and he's going to sweat drops of blood before he goes to the cross. And I think they came and they said, hey, Jesus, come on, man. Come on, you can do this. Complete this mission. Go through with it. And I think they encouraged him. You know what else? I think Moses and Elijah longed to meet Jesus when they were walking on this earth. Moses said things like, God will raise up a prophet among you, prophesying about Jesus. Elijah prophesied about our salvation. And I think they longed to meet him, and I think God is so awesome because he brought them in. And they had this meeting, and Peter, James, and John got to see it, and they got to hear what was going on. I'm telling you what, I like to have been there to listen to that conversation. Wow. Wow. How awesome. Matthew 5:17 explains why Moses and Elijah met with him, okay? Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17. As soon as I find it, I'm going to read it. It says, "Do not think," these are the words of Jesus, "that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." What did Moses give to the Jews? The law. And Elijah represents the prophets. And Jesus came to fulfill the law and the prophets. And so before he goes to the cross, they come, Moses and Elijah appear to him. And he's going to fulfill the words that they've been speaking. It's powerful. It's powerful. One day I was walking across the garden. I was going from my house to my mom's house. And I was walking through and I was reading this stuff. And I said, "God, I think it's unfair. I think you should have had Abraham on that mountain. He's our father of faith. Why didn't you have Abraham there?" And you know what God said to me? He said, "Because I'm God and you're Dave Adams." And I thought, that's good enough. But the very next morning, he took me to Matthew chapter 5 to show me why Moses and Elijah were on the mountain with Jesus. When people tell you Scripture doesn't fit together, you tell them they're wrong. They're wrong, because this is thousands of years of history coming together, and all the puzzle pieces are being put in place. Once again, don't forget the title, Faith to Face the Cross. Jesus brought Peter, James, and John so they could see this happening. And I believe that Moses and Elijah encouraged Jesus, and I think Jesus encouraged them. I think they longed to see that day. And it's all coming together on the way again to the cross. Now, if you're following in your outline, Peter's bright idea was interrupted by God the Father. Peter had a bright idea, didn't he? It was an idea from a man. He said, "Hey, Lord, it's good that we're here. We'll put up three booths. We'll put up one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." And before he got to the place where he could say, "We'll charge a quarter or a nickel or a dollar or today $10 to come in," a cloud came over. Cloud came over him. It says Peter didn't know what to say. Imagine that. Sometimes when you don't know what to say, let me give you some advice. Just be quiet. It's all right. And he didn't know what to say, and he was just spouting something out. And it was interrupted by God the Father. And look at your next point. Jesus' glorious identity is confirmed by his Father. Can you imagine for a minute what this did for Peter, James, and John? A cloud comes over them. Jesus there in all his glory. And the Father says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." The voice booms from heaven. And then he says, "Here's the greatest advice. Please don't miss this. If you take anything home today, take this one home. Listen to him." So inquisitive minds would say, "What did he say?" Read it. You can have at it. Read at it all the red letters. And listen to him. Listen to him. I'm telling you, you talk about a life-changing day in somebody's life. My goodness. All right, so Jesus comes back to normal. It says all they saw was Jesus there. It all ended. They saw Jesus. They're walking down. And Jesus tells them, "Don't tell anybody what you've seen until I have risen from the dead." Look at the point. Peter, James, and John have a big secret to keep until the resurrection. Anybody here ever have a secret? Woo. This one would be tough to keep, wouldn't it? Can you imagine Peter, James, and John going down that hill wanting to go to their disciples? You just wouldn't believe what we saw there. And you know what? If they told them, they wouldn't have believed it. They maybe would not have believed it. But once again, Look at how it confirms the identity of who Jesus really is. He says to him, he says, don't tell anybody until after I've risen from the dead. Do you remember from last week's message that once Jesus told the disciples he was going to go to the cross and he was going to die, they never even heard the words, we'll rise in 3 days. I don't think it ever hit them. They were so concerned with Jesus dying and that death had taken over them that they didn't hear, we'll rise in 3 days. It appears to me that this time they heard that he was going to have the resurrection, because three of the disciples are asking what Jesus means by the resurrection. They're walking down and they're going, what's he talking about? He's going to rise from where, and what's going to happen, all right? Now, before we move on, let's get into this text a little bit. Can you imagine when they saw Jesus in all his glory, and then Jesus says to them, we read it in the text, it's just a few verses away from where we were in 30 through 32, that he's going to die. Could you imagine what it was like in their mind after seeing a glorified Jesus telling them, I'm going to go to Jerusalem and they're going to kill me? I don't know about you guys, I would have said, there's no way, Lord, that they're going to kill somebody like that guy I saw glorified up there on the mountain. You talk about a brain twister, huh? But that's what's going on. I actually think after they saw Jesus in his glory, they could embrace the resurrection a lot easier than they could him dying on the cross. What do you think? But Jesus strategically took them up on that Mount of Transfiguration and let them see him in his glory to build their faith so that they could face up to the cross. Then they start asking Jesus questions. Your next point. The disciples' question about Elijah reveals the spirit of John the Baptist and how it relates to the Messiah. They came down and they said, hey, Lord, if this is all going to happen, doesn't it say that Elijah will come first? I'm surprised Jesus didn't say, who did you just see up there talking to me? But that's not how he answers it. If we go to Matthew chapter 17, in Matthew chapter 17 and verse 13, it's the same account about the transfiguration. And they ask about Elijah coming back. And look at verse 13. Then the disciples understood that he was talking to them about John the Baptist. John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah, introducing Jesus to the world so that our sins could be forgiven. I want you to know that in the text it says, in this place when they ask about Elijah, he says Elijah has already come and they did to him what they wanted. They were speaking about how they beheaded John the Baptist. And then Jesus says, in the same way, the Son of Man is going to suffer. And then it says they understood that was John the Baptist coming in the spirit of Elijah. Can I let you in on something? If you read the book of Revelation, there's two witnesses coming. One of those guys, I think, comes in the spirit of Elijah too in the book of Revelation. And this guy just keeps hanging around, doesn't he? It's going to be fun to meet with him. But the fact is, it comes and they start to understand. Your next point, your last point. Experiencing God's glory and understanding John the Baptist's role prepares the disciples to face the cross. It prepares them to face the cross. You see, God won't put you into a situation and not give you help if you need help. And when you come face to face with the cross of Christ, and when you come face to face with your cross to bear. Remember last week, Jesus told the disciples he wasn't the only one with a cross to bear. He says if you're going to follow him, you got to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him. And this week, Jesus reveals his glory to three of his disciples. He explains to them what's going on in history with John the Baptist and the spirit that he came in, the spirit of Elijah, which sets up the world for the Messiah. As we come to a close this morning, what about you? Do you have a clue of the glory of God? You see, it's things that words just can't explain what God has prepared for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. It hasn't entered into the mind or the heart of man what God has prepared for those who love him. So think about the greatest superhero you've ever known or seen, and Jesus is a whole lot more. Do you know that? You can put them all, you can wrap them all up in one ball. Do you guys know that they used to write comic strips and they were types of Christ? They actually wanted them to look like a hero that would point to Jesus. That's before our world got so messed up. And I'm here to tell you this morning, you can take all the superheroes, you know. You can take the Fantastic Four and all the other ones, I forget what they call them now in the movies, but when they all come together, Jesus will wipe them all out. He's tougher than all of them put together. He's more kind. He's more loving. He's more generous. He's free. Have you ever thought of the glory of God? You see, so many Christians think about what they're escaping, the fire of hell. Don't concentrate on what you've escaped. Concentrate on what lies ahead for you. It says there's no pain. It says there's no sorrow. It says there's no more tears. My goodness, no more death. That's what it says. It says there's no more death. And you know what else? The devil's going to be locked up. Come on, say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is that going to be good? I mean, he's not going to tempt me. Because he's going to be locked up. I can't hear him. He can't get in my head. The glory of God. Whiter than anyone could bleach him. More awesome. So awesome that I think Peter, James, and John, they just hit the deck. You know that? You talk about being under the power of God's Spirit, they just hit the deck. That was it. If you're in here this morning, and you don't know where you're going to go when you die, don't leave without praying with somebody. Because you could miss the glory that God has for you. It says we'll be glorified with Jesus. Do you know that? But you have to claim him like Peter did last week. You have to claim him as the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God. You have to confess your sins and ask Jesus to forgive you, and you have to accept what he did on the cross for you so that you can share in his glory. Heavenly Father, it's my prayer this morning that somehow, by the power of your Holy Spirit, you could get us a picture and you could give us hope of the glory that waits for us. It says the suffering of this world is small in comparison to the eternal weight of glory that you have for us. Lord Jesus, I pray that by your Spirit you would bring revelation of that glory. And that, Father, we could look forward and that we could have hope and that we could have vision, Father God, to be with you for eternity and be prepared to face you on the cross and to face the cross you've given us to bear in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray for you. If you need time at the altar, there's time. If not, you're free to go in peace to love and serve the Lord. God bless you.